In our Christian world, we look around and we see many that we would call superheroes. We can narrow the focus down to our denomination, and we do that there. We have what we call our superstars, if you will. All denominations have them. For Southern Baptists, we might look back in history and say, you know, we think of, and history for me, I think of W.A. Criswell, Adrian Rogers, some of those great biblical names, those biblical teachers and preachers and men of God that took stands and preached God's word so faithfully. Today we have those heavy hitters. Henry Blackaby, one that's maybe a little bit on yesterday because of his health. He's not able to do what he's been doing in the past, but we've got Henry Blackaby. We've got guys like David Jeremiah, Jack Graham, Johnny Hunt, Mack Brunson, David Platt, and we can name several more. It's great to have those kind of guys, and as you look at those, you want to be thankful to God for what they're doing or have done in the kingdom of God. But I think sometimes the problem we can get into is when we start looking at those guys and we go, wow, look how he's being used. Look at what he's doing. Look at what he's doing for the kingdom of God. And then we look in the mirror and we can ask, well, who am I? Who am I in the overall scheme of things? Can God really use someone like me? Someone as insignificant as I am? And we start asking and we almost feel inferior. And so today I want us to look back on this Palm Sunday, the first Palm Sunday that the Bible tells us about as Jesus enters into the city. And I believe the Bible answers those questions for us. And it will help us see that we are not insignificant, that God, even though we think we might be, God can use us for royal service. So would you stand with me as we read Matthew chapter 21, verses 1 through 10. And if my notes fly off this morning, somebody grab them, because I'm in trouble if they're gone. Beginning with verse 1 in Matthew 21, it says, "And when they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, telling them, 'Go into the village ahead of you. At once you will find a donkey tied there and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you should say that the Lord needs them, and immediately he will send them.' This took place so that what was spoken through the prophet might be fulfilled. 'Tell daughter Zion, see, your king is coming to you, gentle and mounted on a donkey, even a colt, the foal of a beast of burden.' And the disciples went and did just as Jesus directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt, and then they laid their robes on them, and he set on them. A very large crowd spread their robes on the road. Others were cutting branches of trees and spreading them on the road. And then the crowds who went ahead of him and those who followed kept shouting, 'Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven.' Then he entered Jerusalem, and the whole city was shaken, saying, 'Who is this?' Lord God, we thank you for your word, and we ask your Holy Spirit, who is here today, to be our teacher. Lord, help us to see who we are in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Did we read that right? A donkey? Not a stallion, not a great white horse, a donkey, just a common old nothing donkey, really? And if you go back and look, really, a donkey. It was Jesus' plan. He chose a donkey. So let's look at this unlikely choice and see what we can learn from it. And the first thing I think we see is that the donkey was selected. Jesus picked this donkey out even before the disciples entered the town. He knew exactly which one it was. He didn't say, "Hey guys, run into town and find a horse or find a donkey and bring him to me. Just any old donkey will do." Now, if you look at the description that he gave, he told them, as soon as you enter, there will be this donkey tied there, and the mother will be there, and you'll see them. And so there was no doubt as these disciples entered into the city which donkey he was talking about. He had selected it. You say, well, what's that got to do with anything? Well, let me tell you, God has selected you. God has selected you. Regardless of how insignificant you might feel, regardless of how unworthy you might feel. John chapter 15, verse 16 says, you did not choose me, but I chose you. I appointed you that you should go out and produce fruit, and that your fruit should remain. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, for we are his creation, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared ahead of time so that we should walk in them. We're selected. We're selected for a purpose. We're selected, and that purpose is part of the plan of God. Now, I think sometimes we get off track when we say, well, God has a purpose for my life, because that kind of puts me in the center. But God has a purpose, and your life is part of it. Your life is part of God's purpose. You say, well, what is it? Well, Romans chapter 8, verse 28 and 29 answers that question. Paul says, we know that all things work together for the good of those who love God, for those who are called according to his purpose, for those he foreknew, he also predestined. Predestined for what? Glad you asked, because Paul answers it right there. He says, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son. He has selected you, and he has selected you to be in the image of Christ, to become more like Christ, to have your life not only transformed or changed in salvation, but it is that process of becoming more and more like Christ. His purpose for us is to be more like Christ, to perform good works that he has and he will provide so that we can bear fruit. He has selected us. Now, you might see yourself more like a donkey than a stallion. You might think, what on earth could God do with me? Well, folks, let me tell you, God working in us makes all the difference in the world. I must decrease that he might increase. God knows you intimately. God knows what makes you tick. God created you, so he knows what you have in your life. He has placed it in your life to be used for his purpose. Tells me that it's not because of who I am, but it's because of whose I am. It's because I'm his child. It's because I'm his servant that he'll use me. We are selected before salvation. We're selected before birth. You can't read Jeremiah without seeing that. Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5, he says, I chose you before I formed you in the womb. I set you apart before you were born. I anointed you as a prophet to the nations. Kim works great with our theme, our walk for life. You ever thought about that? That God put all this together? God planned it before you were ever born. He knew who you were. He selected you. Jeremiah 29:11, I know the plans that I have for you. Plans for your welfare, to give you a future and a hope. We are selected before birth. We are selected for salvation. We are selected for service for God. So it doesn't matter if you feel like you don't have all the tools. It doesn't matter if you don't feel like, matter of fact, it probably is very helpful if you feel like you aren't worthy to be used, because it makes you much more usable for him. You're much more prone to be pliable as the clay would be in the potter's hand, to be used, to be formed into who he wants you to be. You are fit for royal service because you have been selected. The second thing that I think we see here is that as we look at this donkey is that we're set apart. Not only have we been selected, and I know we can get into all kinds of discussions on that, but that's not what we're here for. I think sometimes we get caught up in those kinds of discussions and we miss the point. Someone said, well, how do I know if I'm one of the selected ones? How do I know if I'm one of the elect? I love the way Johnny Hunt does it. Are you saved? Yes, then you're one of them. You know, would you like to be saved today? Yes, then you're one of them. You know, quit making such a big deal out of it. Let God just be God and realize that He has selected you. He wants to use you. He wants to use you in a very, very unique way. It'll be different for you and for me. That's what makes the church what it is when He brings us all together and He puts us all and He uses us in the way that He chooses to make His body. We're those different parts of the body. We're selected, but we're set apart. Notice that this donkey had not been ridden. It had not been used for any other purpose. You say, well, what does that have to do with me? Well, 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 21 says, so if anyone purifies himself from anything dishonorable, he will be a special instrument, set apart, useful to the master, prepared for every good work. See, as Christians, we are not to be like the rest of the world, indulging in all the things the rest of the world does. Now, that doesn't mean that we can't enjoy life. That doesn't mean that we can't have some of the finer things of life. If God allows for that, that's great. We don't have to be monks. We don't have to be put away somewhere and never be around people. As a matter of fact, what I see in Scripture is we're supposed to make the difference in the world, and that means we've got to be out there amongst the world to make a difference. We've got to be out there to be the salt and the light in the world. But we are to live life different. We are set apart for a greater service. Set apart for a greater service for the kingdom of God. You say, well, what do I do with that? Think about your schedule. Think about your time. Think about your priorities. Are they set in such a way that anyone that could look at your priorities, anyone that could look at your calendar, anyone that could look at your checkbook would say, this person is obviously set apart for something different. There's just something different about them. They're not the same. See, what we need to do is preserve our energy and preserve our time, our schedule to be used for service to the Lord. You know, sometimes I think the reason the church can't do as much as God's called us to do is because what we end up doing is giving God our leftover time. We do everything else. We set our calendars. We set our work schedule. We set our vacations. We set our playtime. And then if there's anything left over, God, we can do this for a few minutes. God, we give you a little bit of this over here. And you say, well, Pastor, you're just saying that because you're paid to have this all the time. I fight the same struggles you fight, folks. I've got the same number of hours in a day and in a week as you have. And there are those things that I would love to be doing, but there are those times that I need to say, Christ first, which is all the time. Christ first, and then the other things. I found if I'll put Him first, if I'll make Him the priority of my schedule, I'll still have time to do all kinds of other things. He wants us to enjoy life. He just says, put me first. I've set you apart. I've made you different. So act like it. Once the donkey was secured, it had to be prepared for Jesus. Now, the picture we get there is the cloaks put over it, preparation, getting it ready for Jesus to sit on and ride into the city. When that applies to us, 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 15 says, but honor the Messiah as Lord in your hearts. It starts with your heart. If you start trying just to do things because it's the right thing to do, or it's what the church says, or it's what God says, I'll just do it because it's the right thing to do, folks, you'll never be successful at it. It has to start in the heart. He says, but honor the Messiah as Lord in your hearts. Always be ready to give a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that's in you. In a world that's turned upside down, In a world that seems to be going crazy, do people see the hope of Jesus Christ in your life? When you read the newspaper and you watch the news, do you come away as depressed and as upset as everybody else? Or can you look at it and still see that God's in charge? And still have faith that if you, even if you don't understand it, that God is in control and He's sovereign? That's the way God calls us to live. We've been set apart. We're to have a different mind, a different heart, so that we can give defense to that. I think that's what the world desperately needs today. The world's looking at things and they're going, everything's upside down. Things are different than we ever thought it would be. I mean, the more I read, the more frightening it can be. But Christians ought to be the ones saying, wait a minute. Let me tell you about the Lord. Let me tell you about Jesus. Let me tell you about Christ. That's why we're set apart. 2 Timothy verse 2, or chapter 2, verse 15. Be diligent to present yourselves, not someone else. Don't be trying to clean up other people. Let the Holy Spirit take care of that, even if it's your spouse. Be diligent to present yourself approved to God, a worker who doesn't need to be ashamed, correctly teaching the word of truth. Today, we need to take time to prepare ourselves. And I just need to be honest with you, because I found it in my own life, so I can attest to it. Just listening to a sermon once a week is not enough. It just won't prepare you. It's kind of like getting an object that you've got to put together, and we got an elliptical machine the other day, and I printed off all the instructions, and man, that was tiring. And I got to looking at that, and if I'd have just read the first page or two, that thing wouldn't do me any good. It required spending some time in those instructions, seeing how to set it up, seeing how to set the program so it'll do what you want it to do. But you know what? I can read all those instructions all day long. And I can talk about my plan to do it. But if I don't get out of the bed and get on the machine, it's never going to make any difference in my life. It's still going to be the same old belly over the belt. The doctor told me you need to push away from food too. So here's the point. The church can offer all kinds of things. We can offer sermons. We can offer Sunday school classes. We can offer discipleship classes. But it won't change a thing in your life unless you take part in it. Unless you come and allow God through His Holy Spirit to prepare you for ministry, prepare you for what's ahead, it won't help just because it's offered. We've got to spend time in the Word. We've got to spend time reading the Word and hearing the Word and studying the Word and doing the Word if we're going to be the people of God. Later, probably mid-June, we're going to do a little sermon mini-series. We'll stop with our study in Mark for a little while and move into another series. And I'm working with Josh as soon as he gets through with his Hebrew and can think about anything else other than a language he won't ever speak. But as soon as he can get a grade for that thing, then we're ready to go. And Larry and Josh and I are working. And what we're going to do, this is going to be such a powerful series and challenge our thinking and challenge our church in such a way that I don't think that, and I don't believe that we can talk about it and you can hear it on a Sunday morning and just go, oh, that's good. Now that's what we're going to do. So what we're going to do, and it's going to be scattered out through the summer, and we'll preach on it on Sunday morning, and then Sunday night we'll gather and we're going to really start digging into it, and we're going to ask you, what do you think? What'd you hear? What do you see? What do we need to do to change to be able to deal with these issues? Because, folks, the world is changing so fast. I mean, the mindset, the values are changing. I mean, just about the time I think I know where it's headed, then it changes again. And there's going to be huge implications for the church. And we better decide who we are. And we better understand that we're set apart. Because I don't believe we've got a clue of what's coming. We read the Bible and we go, oh, thank you, Lord. We don't have to endure what they had to endure. Folks, I'm afraid it's coming. I'm afraid it's coming, and I'm afraid it's coming to the church right here in America. And the question is, are we going to be the church that follows Christ, or are we going to be the church that folds to the political correctness? And what's it going to cost us to follow Christ, and are we willing to pay the price individually and as a church? And we better be prepared for that. We're going to offer it. But if you're not here to take part in it, and you're not here to deal with it and struggle with it along with us, then we won't make an impact in this world, in our community. So I just hope that whets your appetite a little bit about what's ahead and what's coming. See, if we're going to be fit for royal service, we must not only understand that we're set apart, but we must take every opportunity to be prepared for service so that we'll be ready when it's called upon. In Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5, you notice it says, I chose you before you were formed. And then it says, I set you apart and I appointed you as a prophet for the nations. You're fit for royal service because you have been set apart. But I see a third thing. To be fit for royal service, we're selected. To be fit for royal service, we are set apart. And finally, to be fit for royal service, we are to be satisfied. Now, this might be the most difficult of all. Especially because we live in a world that is so competitive. And I like competition. Okay? Please understand. I mean, that's why I struggle sometimes with soccer when it can win in a 0-0 tie. Who won? There's supposed to be winners and losers, okay? Everybody doesn't get a trophy. You're going to lose sometimes, and then somebody's going to win, and I'm going to do everything I can to make sure I'm on that winning team. You know, that's why you work so hard. And in that world of competition, sometimes we bring that into our Christian life and we get messed up. When I look at this donkey, and I think of what I know about donkeys, and that's not a lot, but they've never really impressed me as being very submissive. But when I look at us, we're not so submissive either. Let me pull out a passage of Scripture and preach on Ephesians chapter 5, and that word, submit, is there, and everybody gets shook up, especially the ladies. And what we miss is the verse before says we're to submit to God. And we don't want to submit to God. We don't want anybody telling us what to do. We want to win at any cost. Being satisfied to be used in the royal service the way God sees fit. As I'm looking at Jeremiah here, I see God telling him, I chose you and I set you apart and I appointed you. But in verse 6, Jeremiah says, but I protested, oh no, Lord God, look, I don't know how to speak since I'm only a youth. And God comes around and tells him, don't worry about it. I'll take care of it. I'll send you. I'll take care of all that. I'll deliver. And he says, then the Lord reached out his hand and touched my mouth and told me, look, I filled your mouth with my words. He was satisfied to be used by God, to allow God to touch him and allow God to work through him, just like a donkey. We must present ourselves. Romans 12, 1 and 2. Therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, I urge you to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this age, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind so that you may discern what is good, pleasing, and the perfect will of God. Submit yourself to Him to be fit for royal service. We are to submit ourselves as instruments conforming to God's will and to God's purposes. But then I've got to ask, what about what I want to do? What about where I want to be? What about who I want to be? What about me? There we go, climbing back on the throne again. Paul says in Galatians chapter 6, verse 14, "But as for me, I will never boast about anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ." What Paul's saying is, it's not about me. If you look at what he's already said, he's got all these diplomas, all these things he could brag about, but he said, I'm not going to brag about any of it. I'm going to brag about Christ, because all this other stuff means nothing. Can I tell you that as a pastor, this is just as hard for me? What about the size of my church? Don't brag about it. What about the number of baptisms? Don't brag about it. What about the size of the offerings? Don't brag about it. It's all God. Just submit to Him. Submit all the glory to Him. Give Him everything. But it's not easy. It's so easy to be dissatisfied in a competitive world, even in Christian circles. So how do you deal with that? Well, recently, Jerry and I went to Florida to the pastor's conference. And as they were talking there, Mac Brunson, the pastor at First Baptist Jacksonville, made a statement. I believe he was the one that said something about a little brochure, a tract. And okay, I was in, been there, done that mode. And said another gospel track, and I just kind of tuned him out. But he kept talking, and he called the name of the track, and it's entitled "Others May, You Cannot." And Jerry's sitting there next to me, and she goes, "Oh, I've been looking for that." I looked there, whoop! And she said, "No, I've seen that before. While we were in seminary, so and so gave me one of those, and I can't find it anywhere." And I said, "Jerry, it's a track. It's how to be saved. You got that down, right?" And she said, "No, it's not like that." And so when we got back, I got online and I pulled it up, and there it was. And I read that thing in my office. And I'm going to tell you, it was humbling. So I thought, this is good. I'm going to try it out on the Wednesday night crowd. Well, if their reaction was what I read, theirs was the same as mine. It was total silence. It just kind of hits you. And so this morning, I want to close by reading this to you. And I'm going to ask you to do something. I'm going to ask you to close your Bibles. I'm going to ask you to put your notes down. You say, "Well, Pastor, I want to write this down. It's too long for you to write, and I'm going to read it too fast." But we're going to have copies in both foyers. If you'd like to pick them one or two up as you leave, feel free to do that. So put the pens up, paper up. Steve, turn your electronic device off. There you go. Don't tweet this to anybody. You can do that afterwards. Just let the Holy Spirit speak to you. Let Him speak to your heart about this idea of being submissive to God's plan. Because, you know, sometimes God's plan isn't exactly what I had planned. And it is a competitive world. So just sit back and listen. Lord God, we ask you to speak to us today. Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit, who is here, will apply these words to our hearts, and it will touch those places that need to be touched. And it will bring conviction where conviction is needed. Lord, do a work in our lives that can only be explained by the fact that you invaded our presence today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If God has called you to be really like Jesus, he will draw you into a life of crucifixion and humility. God's call will put such demands of obedience on you that you will not be able to follow other people or measure yourself by other Christians. At times, he will let other people do things which he will not let you do. Other Christians who seem very religious will push themselves, pull wires, and work schemes to carry out their plans. You cannot. And if you attempt it, you will meet with failure and rebuke from the Lord. Others may boast of themselves, of their work, of their successes, but the Holy Spirit will not allow you to do any such thing. And if you begin it, he will lead you to despise yourself and all your good works. Others may be allowed to succeed in making money or may have a legacy left to them, but it is likely that God will keep you poor. God wants you to have something far better than gold, namely a helpless dependence upon him that he may demonstrate his faithful love for you in supplying your needs day by day. God may let others be honored and put forward and keep you hidden in obscurity in order to produce some fragrant fruit for his coming glory, which can only be produced in the shade. He may let others be great but keep you small. He may let others do work for him and get the credit for it now. The reward for your work is held in the hands of Jesus, and you will not see it until he comes. The Holy Spirit will put a strict watch over you with a jealous love. He will rebuke you for the little words and feelings or for wasting your time. So make up your mind that God is an infinite sovereign and has a right to do as he pleases with his own. He does not owe you an explanation of these mysteries. But if you give yourself to be his child, he will wrap you up in a jealous love and give you the precious blessings for those who belong heart and soul to him. Settle it forever then that you are to deal directly with the Holy Spirit. It is his option to tie your tongue or chain your hand or close your eyes in ways that he does not seem to do with others. And when you are so possessed by the living God that your heart delights over this peculiar, personal, private, jealous guardianship and management of the Holy Spirit over your life, you will have found the vestibule of heaven. What is your only comfort in life and in death? That I am not my own, but I belong body and soul in life and in death to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. He has fully paid for all my sins with his precious blood, and he has set me free from the tyranny of the devil. He also watches over me in such a way that not a hair can fall from my head without the will of my Father in heaven. In fact, all things must work together for my salvation because I belong to him, Christ. by His Holy Spirit assures me of eternal life and makes me wholeheartedly willing and ready from now on to live for Him. Folks, when I read that and I evaluated my life, I was humbled because I realized I wasn't there. And it takes me getting up every day and starting over trying to get to this place. Because I'm competitive. And I'd like so many things in my life. And they're good things, and they're even good things for the church. But God's got a plan, and it might not look the way my plan looks. Philippians 3:10, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. When I get to that place, when you get to that place, as a matter of fact, only then am I and only then are you fit for royal service.